should analyze it. We should get a study. Oh, you don't want a study of this? You just want to grab it?
Mr. President, I remind you that you said you would be strictly enforcing the two-minute rule. We are well beyond 2 minutes of this explanation.
Okay.
He's not done with the 2 minutes yet, Senator Generis.
That's not true. I was telling you myself, Mr. President.
This clock here, Senator Generis, is what I go by. Senator Generis, please be seated, Senator Generis. Senator DeFrancisco, conclude your comments.
I will stop. It's kind of interesting that we were asked to provide a little more time for the minority, but a little more time here is not appropriate.
The budget debates are intensifying, and the Senate Deputy Majority Leader, John DeFrancisco, is here to fill us in on what's happening. Welcome to Your Voice. I'm Julia Lokendy. Senator, let's continue our discussion from the last program about what the Senate is negotiating as top priorities for the budget. Starting with an initiative the governor has vetoed for 2 years in a row, it would fix the unfair handling of military service credit for wartime veterans. Is that included in the Senate budget?
Yes, and what that basically is, veterans in government that are in state government can pay a certain amount of money to buy some years in the retirement system. And that's been true for certain categories of veterans, whether it's Vietnam veterans, World War II, whatever the veterans may be. But there's a whole slew of people that are in those other categories, not during these specific periods of time. And Senator Larkin, who's also a retired colonel in the Army, he has pushed this bill for years. Both houses passed it. May have passed it a couple of times. The governor vetoed it each time, said it's got to be done in the budget. So he doesn't put it in the budget. We put it in the budget. Now, what the result's going to be, we'll see around April 1st.
Another Senate initiative that would help veterans and New York's number one industry, it's a Cornell pilot program to help veterans establish 5 veteran-owned small farms.
There's been many of these proposals. Some have become part of the budget and some not. The concept is to provide more and more incentives to help veterans, especially those coming from theaters of war, to come back and show that they can, in fact, participate in this country again and do it in a way that's productive, that they could become entrepreneurs and have jobs that will help support their families. In other words, help integrate veterans. I was in the Air Force during the Vietnam era. People came back from that war and they were almost spit on because it was just an unpopular war and they were like the enemies coming back. It's totally reversed. After the latest conflicts that we've had, finally people are finally recognizing that these people and their families have made great sacrifices. And this is a proposal to help them be prosperous once they come home.
I want to keep going with agriculture right now, planting seeds. It's a new Senate majority initiative that really focuses on making sure New York keeps producing fresh, local, quality food. Under this plan, the Senate restores the funding cuts the executive budget made to family farms, providing $10 million, reducing taxes on farmers to strengthen bottom lines. There are measures to protect the safety of our food supply and expand research into plant and animal diseases like bird flu and rabies that threaten public health and safety. Also, investing in Cornell, a university that helps advance all aspects of agriculture. This year, we've really been talking about frequent and dangerous water quality and contaminated land issues across the state. The governor put in $300 million for the Environmental Protection Fund. How did the Senate respond to this idea of increasing the level by $123 million over last year?
Well, the governor fortunately had additional money in the EPA budget, and we agreed with the governor to increase that amount because there are substantial environmental issues that have to be dealt with. It seems more and more come up every week, whether it's water quality or whatever. And so we're now in that situation where we definitely need more funds in order to correct those terrible problems, and we agreed with the governor.
And in terms of health and safety, there are so many things that the Senate put in, from Lyme and ticks disease, elder abuse, heroin, domestic violence registry. All of that stuff is on your website.
That's true. And I think we got to do a total show to the issue of heroin. We really haven't talked about that. But this, the more I hear, not only from my district, but it's statewide, the devastation this drug has caused. And, we've got to deal with not only rehabilitation of drug offenders, but we got to make sure these drugs get off the street. So that's worthy of a whole show. But we've got a ton of money in the budget, in our budget, in order to do those things, prevention, cure, and rehabilitation.
Yeah, the Senate added $26 million to the governor's proposal with a total of $167 million.
And that's real money. You think about that. When there's nothing in the budget for this particular problem, and the first kick in the budget is that substantial. So it's a real problem. We're going to deal with it.
So transportation funding, were you able to find parity? That's always something that's spoken about.
Well, parity means different things to different people. The governor doesn't think it means an equal amount of money to each area. And so he's calling something parity, which really, of course, shorts upstate New York. We have added funding in order to make sure that it is true equality, parity, so that both upstate and downstate are treated the same way.
And you are requiring an MOU that lists capital projects, funding, cost estimates, and that's not something that already happens?
This used to be the norm. But what happened when the Dems took over, the New York City crowd took over the Senate, it stopped in 2009, 2010. The reason was we wouldn't pass a transportation budget. The Senate wouldn't, who's primarily consists of upstate New York. We wouldn't pass a budget unless the money for downstate transportation, including the MTA, mirrored what we were getting upstate for roads and bridges. Well, that stopped. It stopped. They just worried about New York City for those 2 years. And then when Governor Cuomo came in, we try to keep this parity. It hasn't quite happened. But more importantly, we have no control over the projects. We have no oversight. So the governor decides that he's going to put X dollar here, X dollars there. You know, it's very easy to shuffle money around, and he's the expert at it. He's really good. He'll find money if he wants a project and it suits him. But there ought to be input from the Senate and the Assembly, both the Senate and the Assembly, as to what are the most important projects in their districts. And that's what an MOU is, a memorandum of understanding that we have to agree to before the money starts going out the door as to the priority projects. Not that we dictate it, but that we have input into what the priority project should be.
Yeah, holding people accountable. What about the Thruway plan? He wanted to put $700 million of the bank settlement funds to keep the tolls.
I would rather have that $700 million, quite frankly, in the roads and bridge funds as long as we get it upstate. Because that's a temporary fix. You put some money in and you're going to hold the tolls down. When that money runs out, what are you going to find, another $700 million out of a settlement that may never come? And that's not the way to budget. It seems to me the key is to make sure that roads and bridges are corrected and made safe. And so I think that's a short-sighted way. It sounds good, like you're going to save some money when you get on the thruway, but realistically I think that's not... It's better planning to use it for roads and bridges.
Mm-hmm. Let's wrap up with ethics. You know, when some of your colleagues brought up certain ethics measures that weren't included, this is what you said.
The ethics legislation that is not sufficient, according to some people today. The fact that it's not in here may just mean it's a bad idea. And the Senate thinks it's a bad idea. There are many people in this House that have certain businesses or professions and would never have run if there was a restriction on outside income. So what we would do with that reform would effectively mean that only we would have a full politician house. This would be a house of politicians with no varied backgrounds that don't have any other information to provide other than what may be politically proper at the time. Well, that's not a reform, that's a regression. I would think some people that were relying totally on their salaries here rather than their independent income would be more susceptible to make sure they collect as much money as possible or whatever else they might do to ensure every 2 years they're going to have their political career. I've said this so many times, and I just don't understand how you get the argument that that would be reform. If you've got outside income, you've got independence. If you're obviously, you're disclosing your outside income, if you use your position in the Senate to enhance yourself, as both leaders found out, yourself or your family, in that situation, there's laws on the books to get rid of them. But they have a blanket thing, and you're much more independent when you vote, in my mind, if your livelihood doesn't depend upon a political position. So, I don't know. I've said it over and over. I don't understand why this could be considered a reform. Mm-hmm.
There are some things that the Senate has passed. Term limits, we've talked about. Term limits, 8-year term limits for leadership and also committee positions. And pension forfeiture. We talked about that last year. The Senate put it in the budget and the Assembly didn't.
Well, that's the point. We put that in the budget. There was an agreement last year, mm-hmm. and the Assembly just backed out of it. So at the very last minute. So to suggest that we don't have any reforms, those reforms make sense. In a strong leadership government, like the state of New York is, concentrating the power on one person forever seemed to be a problem. But if you give a limit, as we've already done, it's already in our Senate rules, that at least it provides for new leadership over a period of time and less chance of someone getting entrenched. Mm-hmm. And so we've got reforms, but the reforms that the good government groups who don't have to disclose, by the way, where they get their money from, which has always baffled me. The good government groups claim that this is a reform. And Preet Bharara, the prosecutor, has said that this would be a reform. I don't get it.
So negotiations continue, and you'll be back next week to let us know?
I'll be back next week, and who knows what we will find out by then.
I can't wait. Thank you for being here, Senator.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator John DeFrancisco. For more details about the Senate budget proposal and to follow how the budget negotiations unfold, defrancisco.nysenate.gov.